which was supposed to start at 1:40, but since it is clashing with too many talks, we thought it'll be better to move it to 3:25. So the Birds of Feather for product and AI will happen in first floor at 3:25 p.m. Thank you. The general notices apply as well. Just please don't bring in refreshments, cups, anything into the hall. Make sure the Wi-Fi hotspots are all off, and please put your phones on silent. So that's all the announcements for now. Over to Anuj Gupta.
So I am Anuj. I'll be today talking about sarcasm detection in context with sentiment. When it comes to sentiment, it's an important subset of it. And how can one build a system that can go about understanding what is sarcasm? The agenda for the day, I'll be introducing the problem. I'll be introducing the motivation, why it makes sense to build such a system in an organization. Why is it a difficult problem? Then we will look at certain approaches, results, and the drawbacks of the current literature. Okay, so what is sarcasm? It is essentially a way of communicating something which is caustic, which is acerbic, a way to communicate a negative connotation to it. So if you look at this, Warren Buffett talking about livable wage, it is a sarcasm because Warren Buffett is almost a symbol of capitalism. And he talking about a livable wage is an example of it. To add to another example is this. I have been given a slot right after lunch to have a technical talk. And this is what every speaker wants. So to define, sarcasm comes from the Greek word sarcasm, which basically means to eat into something, to tear into something. It's a nuanced form of language where it is a deliberate attempt by the speaker to state opposite of what is actually implied. So this looks like a great fun, is a sarcastic way of communicating that I'm not liking what is happening right now. From a business point of view, why is sarcasm an interesting problem? So organizations continuously tap into social media, trying to understand opinions of customers around products, services, and giving real-time customer support. And there are a lot of CRMs which are available in the market to support organizations in this endeavor. And you take any CRM that is available, a key offering that you will come across is sentiment analysis. Now, most sentiment analysis systems are extremely bad at understanding sarcasm. So here I have a sentence. I love the pain of breakup, and what I'm showing you is if the demo from Stanford and Allen, which are almost like the two of the best that are available out here, and both of them believe that this is a positive statement, and both are getting confused by the word I love. The moment they say love, they believe that it's a positive way of saying things. Now, because most sentiment analysis systems go down when it comes to dealing with sarcasm, and we are talking about Twitter as the domain, this often leads to scenarios where the teams are not able to understand and then respond to it in an inappropriate manner, which often leads to PR disasters. And this is something no organization would love. From a research perspective, if you look at the various problems that are there in NLP, some problems are easy, some problems are hard. It is widely believed that things like question answer, summarization, machine translation belong to the category of hard problems. And sarcasm detection is one more addition to this. And any progress that we as a community make in order to build something that can deal with this would actually be a progress also for the NLP in general. And it's only recently that people have actually solved sentiment to a very good degree. So now people have started to look at more nuanced aspects of sentiment, like aspect-based sentiment analysis and sarcasm detection. So be it be from a business side or be it be from a research side, it is a problem that is worth spending time and energy into. And this is what we'll be looking at. So what are some of the key characteristics of sarcasm? So it's a sharp, bitter, cutting expression. It is acerbic in nature. And by definition, the sentiment of sarcasm is always negative. You would have never heard anything saying that I gave a compliment sarcastically. I mean, it is never a positive connotation. What makes it difficult? It is a deliberate play on the part of the person. So the person plays with the language and the nuances of the language to be able to communicate something sarcastically. So it is subtle in nature. It is not that you will have very clear indicators in text saying, hey, this is sarcasm. It will be just a play of language where maybe a word is here or there, or a punctuation or a phrase. Even as humans, to understand sarcasm is not easy. As a matter of fact, there are studies which compare human cognition with sarcasm understanding. It is believed that people who are good at understanding and creating sarcasm are cognitively better than others. When it comes to Twitter, there are additional challenges. We all understand it is a short form of language, at most 280 characters. There are spelling mistakes, there are slangs, there are acronyms, ever-evolving vocabulary. So sarcasm, when it comes to Twitter as a source, it actually ups only from there. So what is the business problem statement that you typically look at? Build a sentiment analysis system which is capable of handling sarcasm. Now in this diagram, this is a typical way that you handle. You have a module upfront which understands whether the inbound text is sarcasm or not. If it is, we know by the definition it's a negative sentiment. If it is not, then we go ahead and do sentiment analysis on it. So for the rest of this problem, or for the rest of this talk, I'm sorry, I'll focus only on. This is not working. So I'll only focus on the part of given an inbound text, how do you detect that it is sarcasm or not? So the scope is an important problem, is an important aspect of when dealing with this. So if you look at this sentence, this is very difficult to decipher that this is sarcasm. You need to understand that she refers to Hillary Clinton. You need to understand that there are facts hidden in this statement, that she is running for the presidential candidate. If she wins, she'll be able to enter Oval Office. There is a history to it, and that history does not bring positive memories to her. This requires a lot of complex work, and it is beyond the scope of this talk to be able to address sentences which are of this complexity. So we will deal only with those sentences where all the information that is needed to detect whether it is sarcasm or not lies within the sentence. And it is for this reason we chose Twitter as the source of data. How did we go about building the dataset? It is primarily based on the source. So we looked at certain hashtags that are used extensively. We looked at certain handles that are known to tweet out a lot of text which is sarcastic in nature. So collecting the positive class, what belongs to sarcasm, was easy. What is not sarcasm is the harder part. That proved to be much harder because everything else is not sarcastic. And that domain from which is not everything is actually very, very broad. So this proved to be a much difficult task. So what we did was we also took certain public data sets, filtered out data from there to be added to the class of what is not sarcasm, over and above whatever data that we collected. Post-cleaning, we got close to 100K data points, 50K per class. And we built a test set which was close to size 20K, but from a different timeline. We actually wanted to understand that how the vocabulary and how the underlying distribution plays on Twitter, how does that affect the whole thing. So the training and the test data were collected from a different timelines. What is available in literature on this? This problem has been discussed. As a matter of fact, Professor Pushpak spent a good time in the morning talking about sarcasm detection. But so lot of the work that is there in the literature actually talks about hand-coded features. So it talks about things like unigram, bigrams, emoticons, capitalization, positive sentiment in proximity of a negative situation. It talks about features based on so people have argued that a sarcastic sentence would have certain words that will come very often and some words which will come very rarely. So people use things like count of the gap between very frequent and less frequent. Another important aspect is what is called incongruity. Incongruity in English means something which is in stark contrast of its background. So a person with a plump face and a very thin body is an example of what is incongruous. So people look at features like number of words which have one sentiment immediately followed by another word which has the completely the opposite sentiment. While these are great features, they work beautifully. From a product point of view, you want to build a more generic system, something that can sustain a more wider inbound traffic. I think I need to be closer to this. This doesn't work. Yeah, looks like. Okay, I need to be on this side. Sure, thank you. So as I said, most of the features that I have spoken about tend to be specific to the data set that you are working with. We wanted to avoid this thing. And what we started to look at was, can deep learning help in some way? And the reason being that you do away with the feature engineering. I mean, we all understand that you give a data of a certain input space, and your model is able to transform the feature space, whereby the separation is much, much more easy. So for this, we first set up a baseline. Dealing with language, the first thing we looked at was certain language models, like LSTM and GRU. But we never had enough data to be able to train them well. I mean, at the end of the day, we only had 100K data points, whereby the RNNs were overfitting very, very quickly. And all we could do was close to 68% the F1. Instead, because we wanted to reduce the number of parameters, we went ahead and looked at CNNs for sentence classification. Right? And we actually got a far, far better number from there. Once we had the baseline in place, the idea was, how do we push from there? So if you look at literature, people have strongly talked about three clues. One is sentiment, one is emotion, and one is personality. So what do I mean by sentiment? So most sarcastic sentences will show a shift in sentiment. So I love the pain. I love the pain present in breakups. So it starts with something like a very strong positive connotation. I love something, but it very quickly goes into a negative side. And this contradiction between love and pain of breakup, I mean, this contradiction is a hallmark of sarcasm. So the natural thing that will come to your mind is, it makes sense to pick sentiment clues and use that as input to the sarcasm model. So people have already done this kind of approaches. But they typically use things like sentiment lexicon, which will be essentially nothing but a dictionary of words and phrases, where for each of them you have the sentiment, and then you would give certain numbers that will go in as features. We instead went about doing it slightly differently. We actually used a deep network, CNN, to extract out sentiment features. And I'll talk how we did that. The second part is emotion. So emotion is all about feelings, happiness, anger, jealousy, grief. And one can have simultaneously many emotions. Sentiment, on the other hand, is a more objective outcome of emotions. Right? It is either negative, neutral, or positive. Sarcastic sentences are rich in emotions. My stellar programming life, job offer, control C, control V, resignation, repeat. I mean, we all relate to it in some sense. But it has lot of emotions to it. There is pain, there is sadness, there is anger, there is disgust. And the idea was, can we use these clues and to help out in understanding what is sarcasm, right? So similar to sentiment, we trained another network which will try and understand only the emotion part of it and give inputs from there. Sorry. The third piece is personality. The central idea is that people have done studies whereby they have been able to show that certain people are far better at understanding and expressing sarcasm as compared to another. So who you are will greatly influence the likelihood of you being sarcastic. And now how do you model this behavioral aspect of it? People have shown that if you look at the history of the communication from the person, then you can actually pick this kind of a signal. And the signal helps very strongly in understanding sarcasm. Now, how do you do it for a Twitter? I mean, at runtime, you have a sentence, right? And you have the user you from whom this tweet has come. Now, either you go at that point of time, pull in the history of the user, and then pick the behavioral clues, or you have a database upfront saying that this is the entire history of the user, and then pick the clue from there. Either of them will have huge implications on the throughput and storage. And most engineering teams would hate to do anything like this, because this would mean a lot of overhead, both at runtime as well as at compile time. So we never went down this thread. I mean, we knew upfront that this is going to be an engineering challenge. So we took a conscious call of not going this way. So we actually dealt only with sentiment and emotion. So what is the larger solution that we had? You have a text that comes in. You have a model for sentiment. This is what I have shown in the green box. You have a model for only the emotion, which is the blue box. And we have our baseline model, which is what we trained on the sarcasm data. Now, the sentiment model was trained on a sentiment data set and not the sarcasm data set. So we built another data set. This was primarily from public domains, which was all about sentiment, dealing with negative, positive, and neutral. we had another model which was trained on a data set for emotion. So we talk about six emotions. And we have the baseline model. And what we do is, we actually take the features from each of this. So all but the last layer, whatever is the output of that, that we take it as a feature. And we combine the three. So we did experiments with both taking the baseline and not. So that is why it is in a dotted box. And then that becomes the feature vector with which we have worked. And this then goes into another classifier. So I'll come to the details now. So sentiment model. So the larger picture is clear, right? So we have a sentiment model, emotion model, and a baseline. So the sentiment model is what I'm going to describe now in detail. So we built a CNN for this. It's a pretty simple CNN. It's a two-layer architecture. We have the data which we took, cleansed, tokenized. This was, the words were mapped to embeddings. I hope everybody is aware of what is an embedding. Embedding is basically a high dimension vector which pretty much represents the meaning of the word, right? And so this, the word vectors were used to initialize the embedding layer. Okay, sorry. So we took three classes, negative, positive, neutral. We had a public data set, and we added some custom data to be able to match to our needs. The CNN that was trained was all about 1D convolutions. How many of you know about CNNs for text classification? Okay. So yeah, I kind of 50-50. So maybe I'll just spend a minute on that. So the idea is pretty simple. So CNNs on image is basically a 2D convolution where you move across breadth and the height of it. In this case, you actually move only across the height of the input. What is the input? You have a sentence. You tokenize it. You map each token to the embedding. So here I like this movie very much. And I have taken a five-dimensional embedding space. So I have seven words and five. So this is a 7x5. Any kernel that is going to operate on it will always have the width equal to the dimensionality of the embedding. So here I have two filters which are of size 4x5, two which are 3x5, and two which are 2x5. You do the same convolution operation as you do in images. You take the vector from there, you apply the max pooling. So in the last from each, we have the maximum value of the vector. We combine all the max, and that becomes our feature vector. This is the central idea of what is CNN for text. And then you have that for your classification, 1 versus 0. So all we did was we took sentiment data, built a CNN in this fashion, and trained to predict negative, positive, and neutral. Likewise, we built the emotional model. So here it's about, we will use all but the last layer of it to extract the features. Exactly the same flow. For this work, we used Glove embeddings from Twitter. So Glove has multiple embeddings that are available. There is one which is trained on close to 2 or 3 billion tweets. And we actually use them directly to initialize the embedding layer. And then it's all about predicting for the six classes: anger, disgust, surprise, sadness, joy, and fear. There are a bunch of public data sets that are available for this. We augmented these data sets with some of our own data. And then again, very similar to how we built the sentiment model. The network was pretty simple. It's not the kind of CNNs that you see in computer vision. We never had the data at that scale. So it's just two layers of convolution, max pooling, then fully connected, and then the soft max. These are the various kernel sizes that we used, typically 3, 4, 5, 6. And then depending on, so for the first one, which was the baseline, trained on sentiment model, so it was only two outputs. On the sarcasm model, the sentiment was 3, and the emotion was 6. So accordingly is the soft max. Throughout this work, we never fine-tuned the embedding layer. The embedding layer was frozen. I mean, this was our first attempt at the problem. So we tried to keep things as simple as possible and see where it takes us. Okay. So again, just reiterating the key takes. So the green box is a CNN model for sentiment. Blue box is a CNN model for emotion. There's a baseline, and we take the features, and from that, the feature vector was fed to a bunch of classifiers. In one, we tried end-to-end, where it was a CNN. The other was logistic regression, and the third was an SVM. And the baseline gave a okay-ish result, but clearly, when you augment this with sentiment and emotion features, we actually saw a substantial increase. So the best that we got was close to 88, which was fairly decent. Now, from the part of future work, you can actually go ahead and try a lot of ideas. Train your own embedding, because it's Twitter, the better you are likely to do better. But you have to deal with the problem of out of vocabulary words very often. So it's better to go towards n-gram character embeddings. Try and collect more data. That actually proved to be one of the more challenging problems in this project. And then try and get back to RNNs and see how well they worked. I mean, in principle, we never had the enough data to be able to say with very surety that this is going to work or this is RNNs are not going to work. Collecting negative data is still a very tricky part of it, because it's a huge domain, and you actually would like to sample your data with a pretty uniform consistency across this. But that is a difficult thing. What we saw was adding public data sets of sentiment. So there are a lot of data sets which are tweets, and these are labeled as negative, positive, and neutral. When we added those to this, the performance increased dramatically. Because it's not just about sentiment clues, right? It is also about how is that related to sarcasm. So we needed a lot of data which is strong in sentiment, but it is not sarcasm, right? Otherwise, the model was doing pretty bad. How do you bring in user behavior? I think that's more of an experiment that we would only do sometime much later in future. Because as I said, it has engineering challenges which has serious implications from a product point of view. So actually, we never went that way. What are the key learnings from this? So one, it's an important problem. From a product point of view, as we mature from a data science part of perspective, having just a sentiment module is not going to be enough. Especially if you're dealing with public domains like Twitter, Facebook, and other, at some point of time, you will have to go and address this beast. Lot of data that is going to come in, you are likely to do very bad because there are long-term dependencies. There are subtle variations. There are references to historic context. As of today, we do not have the techniques which can actually address them in a reasonable fashion as well. I mean, forget about being great. Most sentiment analysis systems are extremely bad at understanding sarcasm. It's a very simple experiment. Go build a data set on sarcasm, and then just try and run through a couple of sentiment analysis tools, and you'll see what I'm talking about. What we worked with was it's a deep learning, so we tried to automate it as much as possible in terms of feature engineering. But still, there is a domain understanding of that any sarcasm will have sentiment and emotion component through it. And that actually helped us a lot. Most important part was both the features that we were taking were from pre-trained convolution neural nets. So there are, computer vision is full of such examples, but there are very limited examples of how pre-trained CNNs can be used in language understanding. Here we actually found that that actually helped us a big time. And yeah, how you collect your data is a very, very important aspect of this particular one, because what is not sarcasm, you need to have a very comprehensive set. Yeah, with that, I'll end my talk. Happy to take up any questions. There is one at the end.
So hi, this is Deepak. So you said about convolution neural networks for text. Just wanted to know, you said you only have a window which is vertical in nature, right? Like a filter.
Right.
So why only vertical, and why not a filter like in images?
Okay. So in images, if you look at what is the image, the data itself is organized in space. If you look at an embedding vector, if you are looking at say a 300 dimension, then you can't say where is a more critical part of the word. The vector as a whole represents the word and its meaning, right? So which is why the convolutions, and if you look at language, the central idea is the units of language, which are words or characters, they compose to give meaning. So it is better to look at vectors which are adjacent to each other in their full view. That is why you have what are called 1D convolutions for text.
Okay.
Kunjan here. So I just wanted to understand, like, all the kernels are...
You have to be a little loud.
Okay, sorry. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yeah, so just wanted to understand, are all the kernels 2D, or like after first convolution layer, you will have 3D kernels as well?
So everything is a 1D convolution here. As I said, the idea essentially is still that the meaning comes from words that are in proximity of each other. So, which is why everything is 1D.
Hi. Just coming back to the comments you made on negative data points. So just wondering if you could elaborate a little more on how you went about collecting that data. Because as I understand, it's important to have negative sentiment tweets, but not sarcasm.
Right. So one, as I said, was a strategy where we took public data sets for which we already had the sentiment. And that became a part of directly of what is not sarcasm. Right. So we actually went through these sets to understand that none of them is a sarcasm, and we put that. The final data set actually came through a lot of iterations, whereby we would train something, evaluate how it is doing, look at what it was failing, and then from there make derivations of what are the kind of things it is getting confused with. And then try and pull data of more of that type and add to it. But if you think carefully, the ideal way of solving this is not a binary classification way, saying sarcasm versus not sarcasm. It should actually be a one-class classification. I know what is sarcasm, and the model is only about that. So when something comes in, it only tells whether it belongs to the class sarcasm or not. Right? But one-class classification techniques, as of today, no, they actually never took us anywhere. I think we have one more in the back.
Hi, this is Siddharth. So I have one question, did you try POS tagging? Did you append the input with POS tagging?
I'm sorry, I'm not able to hear.
So I'm saying, did you try appending the input with part of speech tagging? That right. could have helped. Right.
So did we try putting part of speech tagging? We did try initially, but we did not experiment it with thoroughly to be able to see its effects. POF tagging also for small text like tweet with all kind of language thrown in, it itself was not working well. And then using a signal from there, we actually did not see gains from there.
And another thing is you mentioned that in normal sarcasm detection, the sentence has a, basically there's a change of nature in sentiment, like from positive to negative.
Right.
So I think just an intuition, like bidirectional RNN, or like in the phenomenal paper, the sequence-to-sequence translation, they tried inputting the sentence in reverse.
Yes.
So if you try here, like inputting sentence, reverse it and provide it as a second input,
right.
that may create some correlation.
Right. But for those kind of architecture, we would need much more data than what we had currently. A lot of our time went into building this data set itself, which is why we did not go that way. When we experimented with RNNs, they were overfitting very, very quickly. And we understood that we'll have to spend a lot of time in data collection rather than just being able to build a solution, at least to begin with. But yeah, I completely agree that a bidirectional LSTM should do, at least intuitively, a good job at this.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
I think I'll have to cut you there.
Thank you so much. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Anuj. So next on stage,